Well, I want to talk about safeguarding and give you an update about safeguarding in rowing, what is safeguarding, and also what we have done in rowing. We will start off with definition, with the framework, what are the risks in rowing, and also the resources, and what we are going to do, where are we in rowing, where are we heading. Why in rowing? A lot of people ask, oh, we don't have any cases. Well, that's not true. We haven't had a major case which hit the news, but we know of many cases. Most of them are not swept under the carpet but not being published because of the sensitive topic they manage on a local or a national base. So, but we have a problem with rowing. So, and that reflects that we have several international initiatives from the IOC launching consensus statements in 2006 and 2016. We have a provision in our rulebook in the Code of Athletics about safeguarding. There's been United Nations Convention declaration on that. The IOC Athletes' Rights and Responsibilities Declaration took up that subject. The why is quite clear if you look at that. There has been a lot of bad press around in the last couple of years. And we FINSA are an athlete-centered sport, so we should take care for the well-being of our athlete, but also of our volunteers, everyone who's working FINSA and is connecting to FINSA. So we need to consider how to safeguard athletes, how to protect the integrity of our sport, of the organization, how to protect our staff, our volunteers, and how to promote rowing as a safe sport to our kids. We don't want the kids to go out of and finish their career and having scars for their life because they have experienced abuse or harassment. So we really don't want that. So, give you a little bit of feedback. I mentioned in 2006 there was this consensus statement on overtraining and harassment abuse for children, and it got wide with the 2016 consensus statement, which took all the athletes analyzed what are the forms of abuse and harassment. There has been guidance to the IOCs and the IFs. There is a reporting procedure from the IOC, which starts in Rio with me, that actually the welfare officer was on site in Rio for the whole time and was there to take complaints or to handle people who came to them on a really and reported something. There's also been the launch of the toolkit, which is a very useful resource, and I'm going to show you that later. Protection of harassment and abuse is a very integral part of the Athletes Charter, or Athletes Rights Declaration, as we call it. When we developed it, that merged as being one of the key topics people are really concerned of, and that's why it's now one of the fundamental rights of athletes worldwide. So, here, I've been throwing around a lot of words like safeguarding, well-being, welfare, duty of care, especially violence, abuse, neglect, bullying. What are these words? That's very difficult to answer because it depends on your context, on your culture, on your language. Some are not really easy to translate, so it's really difficult to find a common language. And when I did a paper review for the science conference, a lot of paper use different terminology, so it's really difficult to know what we're talking about. So I'm trying to give you a few definitions of what we mean, of what words we use, what we mean by that. So if we talk about safeguarding, that's basically the protection, the preventive measure of everything, every action we do to prevent any harassment and abuse for our athletes or our visa members. If we talk about child protection or adult protection, that is a more reactive set of actions. So if actually someone is experiencing harm or is just about to experience harm, that's the protection measures we take to take that person out of this contact. Abuse, I can only read it, it's acts of omission and commission that lead to a child and athlete experiencing harm. That's very, very difficult. There's physical abuse, there's psychological abuse. So it's really difficult, especially if you're not an English speaker. Violence, the United Nations definition is that's all forms of physical mental violence, injury and abuse. So you see, there's a lot of crossover between abuse and violence, and it's not really clear in all the cases. The IOC has a big sort of sporting background define what's violence in sport, and according to non-accidental violence, which I think in sport we can really rely on, they define there's a psychological harassment abuse, which can then lead to non-accidental violence, the sexual abuse, harassment abuse, physical abuse, and forced exertion, so overtraining, letting people train even when they're injured. That's that kind of forced exertion. Neglect can be also a form of violence in sport, and also bullying, which goes more into the psychological harassment. When we look at data, I'm just going to use one study, which was a big study of 4,000 athletes, Dutch and Belgian athletes. And they looked, it was a retrospective study, and it shows that, in a very high percentage of people, athletes are experiencing what we call violence, either psychological, physical, or sexual. And I think what's most astonishing is that lesbian, gay, bisexual, elite athletes, and disabled athletes are at the highest risk. So if you look at the data, like 42% of elite athletes experience psychological harassment. If you go to physical harassment, it's quite shocking how high the numbers. But one in three disabled athletes experience physical violence in their careers. And if you go to sexual violence, those are really strong numbers. These are not rowers, that's athletes and other sports, but we don't have really a rowing study, but we have to assume that in rowing there's some kind of similar numbers and figures. So in an athlete's life, when is the most vulnerable point? It's always at that stage where there's a big differential, power differential between the coach and the athlete, or the team leader or the athlete, or the peer athlete, and the one coming up. And it's usually at the stage where they are just about to reach a higher level. So it can be graduating from under 23 to senior level. It can also be getting from sort of the smaller boat into the bigger boat, if that's the main boat. So this stage of imminent achievement cannot occur only once in an athlete's life, but it can occur actually several times. So, and incidentally, this is also the time where there is a high risk of doping and high risk of overtraining. So many, many things can happen in that crucial time. So, why do we have a problem in sport? Because I think sort of the culture is that athletes are supposed to be strong and that they have to deal with everything, and sometimes it's a fear of not being believed, or as I said, when you're just about to reach that top boat, you don't want to speak up because you fear that you've just been not selected. There might be shame or guilt, and in children it's also sometimes difficult to speak up when there's an adult involved. And I just want to show you quickly, a movie of mom. That's just children, but I think adults and athletes are a little bit in that way because they're very dependent on coaches and, you know, on the team. So coming back to a little bit of jurisdiction. When we're talking about developing a policy, we really have to see where we are jurisdiction-wise. If you're an international federation, you probably go to the international law or special instruments. But on a club level, you have to go to your local authority. So it's not easy to have one policy for all athletes. That's when we started talking about the Ethics Commission. We thought, yeah, all athletes. But it's not really that easy because there are different levels of jurisdiction. So that has to be taken into account. So when we started developing the policy, we relied heavily on the toolkits, on the resources which are openly available. So if anyone wants to go to the federation or to their club, there are online tools. That's the IC safeguarding toolkit I mentioned, but International Safeguarding Children's Board is one of the resources. There's the International Safeguards, which help you go step by step through in developing your policy. So coming back to FISA, as part of the IC Charter, they asked the International Federation to develop policies, and these are the core bits of the policy. In FISA, we, as I mentioned, have already the Code of Ethics, but that's just one part of the whole package. So there is a framework that has to be developed. We have to, you know, work about the definitions. We have to work about procedures, how to actually fill that policy with life, and that's what we're doing at the working group. So talking about the working group, so how did everything start? In the Ethics Commission, we've been playing around with the topic for a while, but with the launch of this toolkit, we decided to take that on board as one of our jobs. And we had the first meeting in April this year in London, where we had Anna-Marie and Gunam and Lucy joining us, and we actually started working on the first draft of the policy and also in an Ethics Commission statement. From that, we put together a working group, a safeguarding working group, with two members of the Medical Commission, Jürgen and Mike, Anna-Marie and Lucy. We worked with various conference calls and emails and put together the policy, which we presented to the council in Plovdiv, and which was approved in principle, but we had still some a consultation to do with Danny Oswald, who helped us with that. So we're now near the final draft, and actually at the moment working on procedures, job description, website, everything, the whole package which is around. So it's more complex than I thought when we started down that road. The reporting procedure will look a little bit like that. So this is it should be a flowchart that you actually, when you look at it, you have that, you know what to do, what are the steps. Some of them might be obvious, but in a stressful situation, you want to have a need. So we want to make it as user-friendly as possible, and it's going to be online available. And we're currently working also on how the procedures within FISA, on the role of the safeguarding officer, who will be a primary contact for concerns, for reports. And also never forget to provide the individual with immediate support. So take that person out of the dangerous situation and provide some help. So now we're coming to you, because we thought it is something all the commissions in FISA have to take on board and work with it. So these are sort of the question we think is something you should take on board. Where and how does the role of your commission impact on athletes and staff? So where is the interaction? Where do you place safeguarding, to ensure the welfare of athletes and participants? And what else can we do? What prevention measures, what education measures can we do? So this is your homework, which we kindly ask you to take home to your next commission meeting, develop a strategy, and we thought we in the safeguarding working group might join you at one of those meetings and help you with either having a workshop about what is safeguarding, go in depth, because I couldn't cover everything now. So that's our offer. We can come and help you, and then ideally present your strategy in the next joint commission meeting. That's your homework. So, at the end of my presentation, so if there are any questions, or if anyone's starting.
Sorry, surprisingly, I don't have a lot of my voice. With regards to the next steps, and in the case of the strategy being rolled out to the different groups, how soon would we be able to access that with regards to maybe the development program specifically for some coaching education activities?
We hope to finally approve the policy in February meeting, in the next council meeting, and we're currently working on the procedures and hope to have them ready by then as well. So it's going to happen within the next month. And it's all going to be online. We're creating a website, a section on safeguarding, where we also want to put all the resource material or links to the resource material, so it's going to be easy to access.
Thank you for all the work.
I know, because they asked me, some federation, they would like to have directions how to move in this area, because in one way the federation are not ready how to react in this situation, and also because these cases, they have different effects in different countries. Something is in North of Europe, something is South of Europe, something is in Asia. So how we can put all together with the samples that eventually should come from FISA.
That's where I talked about the jurisdiction. We really have to be careful, because FISA cannot cover all the countries. FISA would like to do, I hope I'm not speaking right, but to encourage every international federation to have their set of their policy, to develop their policy with their resources, with their local authorities, so they can, within their jurisdiction, have a way to deal with it. FISA cannot deal with every case and on a local level or a local club level, because there's no way we know how it works in Northern Europe, Southern Europe, so this is something every country has to develop. We can either provide the tools, we can provide, what we try to do is sort of set an example of how we think it might work, and so they can follow that, but they have to look at their local resources.
I think it's not only the set up of legislation and the decision of the council, safeguarding is mandatory and harassment is not happening anymore. That's not a great idea. It's a term of discussion inside CISA, inside federations, and it's not there's a deadline for getting this finished, but and Lenka and all the commission did a good work, but we need to adjust to this new standards, and this is something to change somehow in the culture and to support it. Let's say a simple question, when rowers take pictures in the shower of each other and post them, you can send the police in for 14 years old, but that doesn't help the problem. You have to make awareness and select this education.
Yeah, I touched on that, and I took a slide of there are six sort of standards how to safeguard adults or athletes, and one of those is the proportionality. So obviously, yes, you won't send the police in to someone, people that are doing shots in the shower. So the action has to be proportionate to what's happening. But education is a big, big thing. We need definitely to work on the strategies, how to develop education tools and how to educate our people to change the culture.
The same question, we are talking about sending this new policy to national federations, how we can be sure that the leadership of the national federations is not involved in this case.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that I feel that the number one job is providing a very clear model for the national federations to fill in the gaps, because the jurisdictional issue is really critical, and we want to have the whistleblower, the safeguarding officer for each national federation identified, so we, when we hear a case and it's not in our jurisdiction, we can feel safe to send the person to call the national safeguarding officer. And we really need to encourage the NOCs to create the same structure, and hopefully our IOC members and our NOC members who are going to Tokyo can help push that the NOCs take a big part of this as well. So yeah, the jurisdiction thing and model rules, like for WADA, they give us model, IF model rules to fill in the blanks, FISA here, FISA there, so that we're really sure we have solid rules. In the case of anti-doping, we need to do that here.
Thanks, Lenka, for this. It's really good. There's a couple of different parts, and one is education and the prevention. So if we can work first on that, the education and the prevention. And there's a course online with the IOC that we all took, which helps everyone then recognize, because in different cultures, some don't recognize that as an issue. Like when a coach gives you a swat on the head, in some cultures, yeah, the parent says, give him a swat the other way, So it's something that's cultural. So we have to sort of get on the same page first for the prevention. And I would recommend that everyone communicate with their groups and for these courses that we all took, the council took online. In the Canadian Olympic Committee, we had a problem with bullying in our culture in the office. And so what we insisted was that everyone had to take this course so that everyone recognized, even things you wouldn't think were bullying, like nicknames. Sometimes for some people, a nickname will hurt them for the rest of their lives. And so everyone was educated on it. And then everyone is thinking in the same way when they see something. Everyone says, whoa, we don't do that. So everyone says, not just one person saying it, but everyone says it. So it helps prevent it from happening because everyone knows it's not acceptable. So that would be a first step that we could take, is that our whole community could take the course that's offered by the IOC, for example. It's not perfect, but it starts to get you thinking on the same way so that you can really work on the prevention. And then once, if something does happen, we have to have a system in place to manage claims, to make sure that athletes feel safe coming forward, or coaches or anyone feels safe coming forward, and they know that something's going to happen. But the prevention we could do, and prevention education we could take as a first step as well.
Yeah, we felt that before we start with the prevention and education program, we have to make sure that our procedures are solid. That because once we start talking about it and start promoting it, I'm sure there will be some reports of people coming and reporting back, and we don't want to then be there and not to know what to do with them. So that's more we're sort of developing it at the same time. So it's all because we think some kind of policy is more important, and that we need to react in a respectful and an appropriate way. All right. I think that's waving at me. He wants to say hi. I think there are no questions. Yeah, thank you for your attention.